Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's good to be back in the house of God one more time.
Yes.
As God has been good, and He's been good all the time.
Yes.
I know your day may not start good all the time, but there's always something good about the day because God made it good.
Amen.
And so we got to thank God for being so good to us. It's good to see all those who made it this morning. You have something to smile about. And God has been good to you. God has given you so many blessings. Even in the midst of your troubles, you have a lot of blessings that you can smile about. So I encourage you to smile this morning. Because God has been so good to us. He's blessed us one more day. One more day of life. One more time to come worship Him. One more time to sing praises. He woke us up this morning one more time. And He set us on our feet one more time. We got in our cars one more time. Some of us forgot something and we had to go back one more time. If you're like me, I left my keys in my car this morning. And that's not one more time. I don't usually do it. But God has been good to us, and so we have so much to give Him thanks for this morning. Remember those who've lost loved ones recently. So we have some in our family who are hurting, and when one hurts, we all hurt. And we have Sister Tally, who lost a loved one, and Brother Mark and Sister Jean Harris, they also lost a loved one. This past week, when you remember them, to pray for them, support them, and you greet them later, let them know that you're here and you care. You pray for those who are sick as well. We have a few among us who are sick and not doing too well. We have Sister Willhite, who's here this morning. It's good to see you. She's undergoing treatment as we speak, and we want to thank God for allowing her to be here with us this morning. Sister Kyle's as well. Who's also going through treatment. Sister Madison, who's home, not feeling too well, but her spirits are up, and she would love to be here with us this morning. Remember those that we're overlooking. Because I know when you start calling names, you forget some names and you're in trouble. So to all those that I forgot, we're thinking about you too. We also have some good news, because in the midst of difficult news, it's good to get some good news, right? And we have some birthdays, and we had some birthdays this last week, and we want to congratulate you on your birthday. Even today we have Sister Tabitha. I'm not sure if she's here, but happy birthday to you. And we actually have witnessed the birth of a new baby this week as well. The Youngs welcomed into the world the new daughter this week. Imona, I hope I'm saying the name right, but they welcomed her into the world, and Mom is at home taking care of her. It's good to see Brother Young this morning. He's blessed with one more. And so the Bible says, blessed is the man whose quiver is full. Amen. So he's a blessed man. We rejoice with them. Those of you who are visiting with us, it's good to see you as well. It's always good to see new faces. Those who have not been here for a while, good to have you with us. You turn your Bibles to John chapter 17. John chapter 17. And I want to read all of it. I see some of you smiling. But we'll read verse 20 through 23. Basically, this text this morning is just a springboard for where we're trying to go. Springboard for our lesson this morning, from which you will be able to, hopefully, gain something that will help us in our journey forward. The Bible says, I do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, just as we are one. I in them, and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me, and love them even as you have loved me. So this morning, this will be our springboard for our message. You might sing one more song, and then we'll go into a lesson for this morning. Sing one verse of My God is Real.
There are some things I may not know.
Somewhere out in New Jersey, there were people gathering on the streets, lining up the streets, and there were so many. It started in the hundreds, and then they kept coming. And the police decided to barricade the streets so that they could be safe while they stood on the streets. They were gathered to look at something. They were gathered because something of interest had caught their attention. They gathered to look at a tree. A tree which they believed had the scar that looked like the sign of what we call, what they call Our Lady of Guadalupe. Anybody know about that? Like the Mary, sign of Mary according to some religions. They gathered to look at the tree because they saw a sign in the tree that looked like it came from God. That's what they said. And they were looking for God in the sign on the tree. And some came up to it and they touched it. Some came, they kissed it. Some came, they knelt down before it. And they started worshiping. And from afar you look and it looks like, and what it really was is that they were worshiping the tree. And it was sad, but it just reminded me that if you look for God in the wrong place, you won't find him. But if you look for God in his word, if you look for God in his people, you will find him. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you're looking for God, look around you. And look at God's word. And look for God's word to tell you what he's looking for. Because when you see God, you see him through his word. So this morning, as we seek to move on and to show others what Christ has left us here to do, I encourage you to let people see God living through you. Let others see God living through your life. And the Bible tells us that Jesus said that I pray for them so that when men see them, because of the love that they have for each other, they will know that they are of me. So when God looks at us, he wants to see that we represent him. But this morning, that's not what our lesson is on. It's just, this is just a break, if you don't mind. But I guess we could just sit and go home. But no, we came for more than that. And this morning I want to talk to you. Because we're at this time of transition. Where we're going from one door to another. One chapter to another. One phase to another. And if you're here on Wednesday night, you understand what that phase is. And this morning I just want to talk to you because while we go through this phase and we're looking for a new minister to come in, and there's going to come a time when I'll have to decrease, so to speak, so that someone else can increase. And as we go through this time and these transitions, it may be difficult for some of us. Because no one likes to be in stages where there is some uncertainty. Am I right about it? No one wants to be in a place where you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. But when you're with God, it becomes easier. Because God is the one who's taking you through your transition. And what we need to do first is to remember how we got here. Because if you remember how you got here, you will then have comfort in knowing that what got you here can get you to where we're going. And so God brought us here. And so God will take us to where we're going. You know, we didn't do it on our own. We didn't do it working apart, but we did it working together with God. And so, to get to where we're going, we're going to have to do the same thing. We're going to have to work together again. Because what got us here, remember, is what's going to get us to where we're going. So, I want to encourage you this morning to not forget how we got here. We didn't do it on our wisdom, but we did it on the wisdom of God. We didn't do it in our own way, but we did it here because of God's way. We did it not to get some praise, but we did it so that God could get the glory. And so where we are now, we got to give God praise because we could have been somewhere else. And God has seen us through so many things. And he's going to see us through this time. But you know, it's so great when you look at John chapter 17. It is great to have people praying for you. It's good to have faithful men praying for you. But when your God prays for you, it's an amazing thing. Isn't it amazing that we have a God who loves us so much, who before he goes from one transition to another, he stops to pray. And he doesn't pray for himself. He prays for us. He prays that we might be one. And so, if we're going to move forward, we're going to have to do it together. As Christ says, I pray that they may be one. So when we move, when we face the challenges, when we face the mission, we're going to have to do it together. So firstly, we must work together to complete the mission. What is the mission? To live by Christ, to teach Christ, and to bring others to Christ. Now that mission, we need to remember every step of the way. The mission never gets overshadowed by the things that surround it. Hello, somebody. The mission never gets overshadowed by whatever else is going on. The trials may come, yes. But the mission still remains the purpose of our journey. And so, as we remain one, let's remember the mission. You see, though, to complete this mission, we may have to do things outside of what we're used to doing. Hello, somebody. Along the journey, we may have to do some things outside of what we're used to doing. Sometimes it may get uncomfortable when you go through certain transitions. But you have to remember that to get the blessing sometimes you need to step out. And step out of your comfort zone. Anybody been there? You've got to step out of your comfort zone to get the blessing. You see, most times the blessing is on the outside of the comfort zone. And if you're not willing to move to where the blessing is, you may not get it. Isn't it interesting that it's harder sometimes, even when we know what we need to do, that we hold on to what we've been doing? And that can happen in several parts of our lives, that we hold on to something that we've been doing just because it's uncomfortable to reach outside of the comfort zone. If we keep holding on to the comfort, we may never get all the blessings that God has in store for us. And so as we work together, remember that each of us, we're going to have to step out. And sometimes step out of our opinions. Step out of our just what we have in our minds as preferences. Step out of those boundaries so that we can do this together. And sometimes you're going to have to give up some things so that we can get to this new place. And bear in mind, this journey sometimes, this transition, it looks familiar, like we've been here before. Hello, somebody. It looks familiar, like we've been here before. But remember, however, that this is a new day. This is a new time. This is a new period of your life that God has blessed you to see. So we don't want to go into today like we did yesterday. We go in with the new knowledge that God has blessed us with. And so, as we work together, we can complete the mission. If we're not willing to give up some of the comforts, we can't work together. And if we can't work together, we can't complete the mission by ourselves. You know, have you ever looked at an animal being released back into the wild? One that was kept in captivity for a little while. If you notice, when the cage is opened or it's let out, the gate is down, the door is down, but do you notice the hesitation? There's a few seconds of hesitation. It checks for a while to make sure that it's all right, and then it sprints outward. That's because it's uncertain of the environment. And that's how it is when we get to a place when we're uncertain about. Have you ever been to a place where you're uncertain? And you get there and you're tentative. You're free, but you're afraid to put your foot out there. Because you're not sure if this ground is solid enough to walk on. Anybody been there? You've seen these things in your life before because God has given you this opportunity, but you're afraid to step out because you're not sure if that's what you're supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
It's like that job offer that you get. You want to take the job, but you're not sure if it's going to affect your time with your family or your time with God. Or you're not sure if it's going to affect your time in your marriage, in your relationship. And so you're not sure if you should step out. But you see, that's when we fight the flesh. But when you have a spiritual walk with God, hello somebody. When God sets you on a new ground, there is no need to test the ground before walking out. We can just sprint out because when God gives us the ground to walk on, it's always solid.
Yeah.
There's nothing to be concerned about.
Yeah.
So trust God. And know that in this transition, where God puts us, it's always going to be solid ground.
Yes.
But we've got to be ready to walk out to achieve the blessing. But don't get ever so comfortable that when you know what to do, you don't do it. Because that's a dangerous place to be. But isn't it interesting though, that it's one of the most difficult places to be because sometimes the thing that you know to let go of is what's harder to let go of. Hello somebody. That flesh that you need to let go of, you keep holding on to it. It seems like it's the hardest thing to let go of because everywhere you go, it follows you.
Yes.
Isn't it interesting, though, that the things that have no value, the things that are dead, sometimes cause us to hold on to them the most.
Amen.
It's dead, but it's still hurting us and we have trouble letting go of it. Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? That relationship that you need to let go of. Those things that you need to let go of. Those friends that you need to let go of. That habit that you need to let go of. You know that you need to, but for some reason you're so comfortable in there, or the flesh keeps fighting you to keep holding on to it. And it becomes hard. So know this, it's going to be a challenge. Which is why we've got to work together. Whatever your challenge is, whatever your difficulty is going through life at this point of your life, you're going to have to do it with someone else. You can't do it by yourself. Because when you do it by yourself, that flesh is always going to deceive you to go back and to keep holding on to it. Some of us may be going through some things this morning and have burdens on our mind, but we keep holding on to it and we're not sharing it with anyone else. And it's holding us back because we've not let go of what we need to let go of. But if you do it with someone else, it becomes easier. And no one likes to be in the in-between places. Hello, somebody. If you're like me, you don't like to be in the in-between places. None of us do. Because when I apply for a job, I want to know, am I in or am I out? Are you giving it to me or you're not? Tell me something. Let me know. Are we moving forward in this relationship or are we not? Are you stepping up or are you stepping down? Nobody wants to be in between steps. And if you've ever noticed that when you're in between steps is when you realize that nothing is in your control. Because gravity, after a while, will pull you down. Hello, somebody. And that's when we realize, and that's the true test of our faith, when we're in the in-between places, between steps, and you have to balance for a while, and then you realize that you don't have the strength to keep balancing, that's when you have to give the control back over to the one who has it in the first place. That is God. And then you realize, I don't have control of the situation. Lord, take me from here. And if you have someone to walk with you, when you're in between steps, you don't have to do it alone. Someone else can hold you up if you're about to fall. And that's the great thing about working together. Because we don't have to do it alone. But it's hard. But we're going to have to do it God's way so that we can get to where we're going. You know, the question this morning, though, is, what do you do when your skills don't match your situation? Have you ever been there where your skills don't match your situation? You're trying to do it by yourself. You realize your skills don't match your situation. The tools don't match the task. Have you ever been there? You have a computer and it starts acting crazy, but you don't know much about it, and it's outside of your control. What do you do then? What did you do last week when they said, oh, thousands of computers are going to be offline today? What did you do then when you realized it was out of your control? When you're on a job and your supervisor says, I need you to write up a proposal, but you've never done it before. What do you do then? When they say, we need you to do the PowerPoint for the presentation, what do you do then? What do we do? What we normally do is go look for someone else who can help us. Am I right about that? We find someone that we can partner with to get the job done. But what about when it comes to the spiritual things? When you're struggling and you're trying to do it by yourself and you realize that your skills don't match your situation, what do you do then? I challenge you to find someone else who can help you up. Someone who can hold you up. Talk to God about it. Let God help you. And the people of God are here for a reason. We're here to help each other out. What do you do when your situation is beyond your control? Truth is, we're going to have to work hard. We're going to have to work. We're going to have to fight to get the blessings that God has for us. Secondly, not only must we work together to complete the mission, but we must work together to eliminate fragmentation. We must work together to eliminate fragmentation. Now, fragmentation is defined sometimes as disintegration, the collapse or breakdown of norms of thought, behavior, or relationships. The breakdown of the normal. The breakdown of the way things are supposed to be happening. And we see fragmentation in its latter stages. But one thing that's interesting with fragmentation is that sometimes while it's going on, you can't tell it's happening. Those of you who have computers, your computers are being fragmented every time you use it. You may just not even know it. That's why if you remember when you bought your computer and you turned it on for the first time, you remember how fast it ran. It ran real fast. And then 2 years later, you called me up and you said, my computer is running really slow. What happened? I have the same programs, the same everything on it. The truth is how fragmentation happens. Is that when you use the computer and you move files around, you delete files, and you start the computer, you shut it down. What happens is the storage system is being configured every time you use it. So every time you access the computer, it moves files from place to place. And after moving the files from place to place, after a while, they're scattered all over the place. That's how fragmentation works. But notice, in the first 2 years of using it, you never realized that it was being fragmented until it started performing slowly. And performance dropped. That's when you realize this is not performing how it was designed to function. And that's when you could get a diagnosis and you could say, yes, your computer needs to be defragmented. But isn't it interesting that in a unit like the body, fragmentation can happen underneath for a while and no one knows it's happening until we get to a place and we realize I'm not moving forward. We're actually stuck in this place. We can't move. And then you start diagnosing and you realize we have some issues of fragmentation. So my encouragement to you is to fight fragmentation before we can see the effects of it. You know, in every body, in every group, in every unit, there is going to be some disagreements. Let's be real about it. We're going to disagree on some things. But what matters is how you deal with your disagreements. How you deal with your disputes. It doesn't have to be dealt with in the way that the world does it. it in a way that we root out the fragmentation so that we can get back together as a unit. Now, fragmentation is one level, but let's take it deeper. Have you ever noticed that when a unit is fragmented, it breeds dysfunction? Hello, somebody. When unit is fragmented, it breeds dysfunction. Now let me tell you this. I don't know about your government, but I know about mine. And you have two sides. And they're divided on both sides. They're fragmented, but they're trying to work together. And they keep getting fragmented by the day, and they don't realize it. Isn't it interesting? You get fragmented over and over and over again, and you keep pushing each other apart until at one point you realize that the same mission that you were placed there to perform, you're not doing it. Because you're now on the level of dysfunction. You're on another level where you're functioning for yourself. You're not functioning as a unit anymore, but you're functioning for yourself. And that takes us to the next level, where you get so caught up in your dysfunction that you move into isolation. Has anybody been there? Isolation. Have you ever seen someone who's been hurt so many times in their life? Hello, somebody. Been hurt so many times and been thrown underfoot so many times, and they decide on one morning that they get up, I'm not going to take this anymore. I'm done with these people. I'm going to do it by myself. Have you ever seen that? That's what fragmentation does. It leads to dysfunction that then leads to isolation. But you see, we just agreed though that we didn't get to where we are as a unit through isolation. So to get where we're going, we can't have isolation. It's got to be rooted out. And the only way to get to that point where you deal with isolation, dysfunction, fragmentation, is to thirdly implement God's plan of defragmentation. Hello, somebody. Implement God's plan of defragmentation. You know, when your computer goes crazy and starts working slow, one of the things that we do, first thing that you do, the computer technician does, is he runs a test on it to put the files all back in their rightful place. And then when it's back to where it used to be, it functions like it should. It functions just as if it were brand new. Because now the pieces are back in the rightful place. So think about this on the spiritual level. When we function and we have disagreements and we can't see eye to eye, we disagree on some things and we don't talk to each other. I'm not saying that this is happening, but it might be. Because we just agreed that fragmentation sometimes happens underground without noticing it. If you ever looked at your government sitting in the house, you can tell who is against the other. But there's a lot of fragmentation underground until they start speaking. When you start speaking, then your situation is revealed. So this morning, we need to have a plan of defragmentation. You know, now I know that this is against the normal. Just look at our government. Our differences were supposed to bring us together, but we have a defragmentation plan that pushes us apart. Look at our communities, our demographics, our difference of income, our difference in schools, and difference in education. Instead of bringing us together, it is pushing us apart. You look at our homes, our difference in faith, our difference in values, our difference in opinion is not bringing us together, but is pushing us apart. So, what's wrong? The fact is, we need to implement the right plan of defragmentation, because the others don't work. Only God's plan can work to get you defragmented, getting you back to be in the position that you were designed for. Only God can do that. Notice, When you're with God, you implement His values. When you're with God, you implement His system. When you're with God, you implement His standards. And then His standard is what brings us together instead of driving us apart. But notice though, communication is a big part of defragmentation. Hello, somebody. A lot of us who are married know about that word. Some of us too much. We need to talk. We need to talk some more. We need to talk some more. And it still happens. You don't ever get to the point where you catch up. Well, sometimes some of us do. It takes a long time for some of us to get to where we can communicate better. But communication is important if we're going to go back to the way that God has designed us. And that we function most efficiently. To rule out fragmentation, we've got to communicate. If you notice the disciples, when they had disputes, they spoke about it. They spoke about it. When they disagreed, they spoke about it. Some traveled miles, go back to Jerusalem to speak about the Jews who were saying that you need to be a Jew before you can be a Christian. They spoke about it. And the Bible tells us that they had a dispute. But the Greek word for dispute actually means a joint seeking. So they were not disputing as in fighting. They were trying to come up with a joint compromise or decision that was made based on both sides having a problem. We both had to talk about it. When Peter was scolded by Paul, they had to talk about it. When Jesus was scolding the apostles and talking to them of their little faith, he had to talk to them. And so communication has always been a part of God's plan. So I tell you, as we go forward, let's talk about it. Let's talk about some things. If there's something that's bothering you, if there's something that you see that's hindering your growth, let's talk about it. And when we talk about it, we can then root out the problem and then go back to our function. Because with fragmentation, we can't move forward too far. You know something interesting though? When we talk to each other, notice that it has to be done out of love. God's defragmentation plan is always one of love. It has to be done out of love. You know, isn't it interesting that when we fall in love or we have relationships, we grow to the point where we grow past the differences of the other person. Am I right about it? You overlook their differences. You overlook their weaknesses. Some of us have trouble doing it, but it's a period of time that's going to pass by until we get to that stage. And those of you who've been married longer tell me, you know, after a while, those things, you don't even see them anymore. Because you've grown so much in love that you don't even see the differences anymore. But what about when it comes to God's business? Seeing that we have a love that is greater than every other kind of love, what about that? How about growing past the differences? Growing past the weaknesses? Growing past the problems so that we can then work together? To the point where we don't even see the differences anymore. Because love has overcome and overshadowed the small things. So that we can work on the mission. So I want to tell you this morning, if you're here this morning and you struggle with some things and you notice that it's affecting your growth, I want you to come this morning and talk about it. Get it out. Fix it. So that God can see the mission through. But if we want to be part of the mission, we got to be working with the team. Amen. We got to be working with the unit. So if you have parts that you need to get rid of or some parts that you need to fix, let's get it fixed this morning. You see, the thing about it is getting God to fix you is a difficult task. Why? Because for God to fix you, you're going to have to endure some pain. Hello, somebody. For God to get the sin out of your life, you've got to go through some pain. You know, I was sitting on the desk for my first root canal. on the bench at the dentist's office. And I was in a lot of pain. They'd given me several shots, I couldn't remember how many. Because each time they tried to cut in there, I told them, no, it hurts. Give me another shot. And then he went back, they gave me another shot. I said, no, give me another shot. I still feel it. Give me another shot. And then the doctor had to tell me, it won't get to the point where you don't feel anything at all. You see, with us, we want the pain to be gone. We want the fixing without any pain at all. But what they had to tell me when I asked for the last shot, she said, we've given you the legal limit. Because you might pass out if we give you this one. You might not wake up. So to go through the fixing, we've got to go through some pain. It's okay to hurt this morning. It's okay to have something on your mind that you need to let out. It's okay to feel burdened because you've got to go through some pain so that you can get rid of the problems in your life so that God can fix you.
Amen.
Isn't it interesting that the things that are there, they cause us the most pain? That relationship, when it's dead, you lost your feelings for that person somewhat, but you can't sleep, you can't eat, because it's causing you pain. It's no surprise that when we hurt God, when we mess up the relationship with God, that God feels the pain. And the thing that's dead is just so interesting that it causes you so much pain. Like the tooth, when it dies, it causes you the most pain. You think you're going to die. Things in our lives that cause us the most pain are normally the things that we need to get rid of. This morning, I want to encourage you, if you have something that you need to get rid of this morning, why not come? Come down, get rid of it. Let God deal with it. Let God cut it out. And don't be afraid because of the pain that you have to go through. Every one of us have to go through some pain before we can get the healing. Let God do the healing. But we've got to go through the process before we can get the blessing. If you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, you want to get healing in your life, and you want to get God to fix some things in your life, first you've got to be ready to give up that other thing that you keep dragging along with you. Give up the dead side of you. Let God cut it out. You know what? The dead side of you, if you try to get rid of it by yourself, it won't happen. Because you see, the flesh has its interests at heart. It won't let you cut it off. It won't let you cut it off because it wants to be attached to you. Only God can cut you off from the things that burden you down this morning. So if you're ready to get rid of it, let God take care of it. If you're willing to give your life over to Him, if you're willing to get baptized and go down with Him in baptism to be raised a new creature, He's willing to forgive you of all your sin. There's no sin too big that God can't fix. So why not come this morning? If you're here and you're struggling with fragmentation in your life, and you're on a mission but you lost track of the mission because of fragmentation, come get defragmented this morning so that we can get back to our function and complete the mission with God. Why not come at this time as we stand and as we sing?